towards the world. So let's begin with the first one. What does the church say of herself? How does the council see the church? The dogmatic constitution on the church, Lumen Gentium. It deserves to be considered first. Although the document on liturgy was first promulgated, but this one we will consider first because, in a way, it is a key to understanding the other 15 documents of the Second Vatican Council. This will become clearer as we examine some of the preparations for the Great Constitution. We give a summary then of what the Council Fathers say in the 8 chapters of this document. We survey also how each of the other documents fits into this vision, and also say a word on how Lumen Gentium has influenced church life and church reflection and meditation these 50 years. Some preparatory steps. Everything didn't happen immediately. Lumen Gentium did not arrive like a bolt from the blue. Many events in the life of the church in earlier decades were providential preparations for this great Vatican II document. It will be recalled that the First Vatican Council from 1869 to 1870 was interrupted by the Franco-Prussian War, and so it remained somewhat one-sided. After defining the infallibility of the Pope, it did not have the time to go further into broader ecclesiology as had been earlier planned for Vatican I. Reflection on the nature of the church was growing. Vatican I had also envisaged the church as the mystical body of Christ. In 1943, Pope Pius XII, a great pope, appreciated more and more as time passes, in his encyclical letter, Mystici Corporis, he went deeper into consideration of the church as the mystical body of Christ. Theological reflection was also growing, which saw the church not just as an organization headed by the Pope and the bishops, but also and especially as a living body of the baptized, who are the new people of God. The collegiality of bishops with the Pope was also a growing conviction. The liturgical movement helped greatly to see the public worship of the church as an act of the whole church and not just as act of the clergy with the lay people present, much more than that. The renewal of Holy Week liturgy, inaugurated by Pope Pius XII already in 1952, the older priests will remember that, it was an important factor in promoting a more conscious realization of the whole church, offering worship to God with Christ at the head. And we might add that the Holy Father allowed modified Eucharistic fast from midnight strict to 3 hours. Later on, it was reduced to 1 hour. And some people don't even observe that 1 hour, but not the people in La Trobe. You just imagine in those days, if the priest took even water after midnight, he could not celebrate Mass the whole day. But today, with Eucharistic fast time reduced, we can have a Mass at 8 or midday or even evening. It means much. There is therefore no surprise that from the beginning of Vatican II sessions in 1962, along with sacred liturgy, attention was given to the church. Finally, the reflections matured and reached their final stage on 21st November 1964, when the dogmatic constitution, Lumen Gentium, was approved with massive majority by 2,151 votes of the bishops in favor. Those not in favor, 5. Before we begin to comment on the document, let's summarize what it said in its 8 chapters. They are built according to an internal logic, which becomes clearer as we proceed. The key concept is the first chapter, which considers the church as a kind of sacrament of intimate union with God and of unity between people. The church, or in other words, the kingdom of Christ, now present in mystery, grows visibly in the world through the power of God. The kingdom of God now present in mystery. The famous paragraph 5 of Lumen Gentium. Every man and woman is called to this union with Christ, which is the light of the world. Who is the light of the world? The term mystery indicates that the church, as a divine reality inserted into human history, cannot be completely understood in human concepts or in human language. Founded by Christ and enlivened by the Holy Spirit, the church is sent by Christ to announce and inaugurate among all peoples the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Christ, which is the same kingdom. She becomes on earth the initial budding forth of the kingdom. Some scriptural images help to understand the mystery of the church. She is called variously, sheepfold, flock, the field of God, the edifice of God, household of God in the Spirit, in which dwells God's family, holy temple, that Jerusalem which is above, our mother and spotless lamb, spotless spouse of the spotless lamb. All figures, images, none of them exhausts the mystery. Put together, they help us. The church is the mystical body of Christ, which incorporates people by baptism and feeds them in the Holy Eucharist. She is a community of faith, hope, and charity, and has a visible structure. The famous paragraph 8, this church, constituted and organized in the world as a society, subsists in the Catholic Church, which is governed by the successor of Peter and by the bishops in union with that successor. Although many elements of sanctification and of truth can be found outside of her visible structure. While Christ obviously is sinless, the church, says the council, embracing sinners in her bosom, is at the same time holy and always in need of being purified, and incessantly pursues the path of penance and renewal. The second chapter is on the people of God. On the concept of the people of God, there is continuity between the Old Testament and the New. The big difference is the Christological element. Only through Christ do we become the new people of God. We are the people of God the Father, the body of Christ the Son, and temple of the Holy Spirit. This messianic people has for its head Christ, for its heritage the dignity and freedom of the children of God, for its law the new commandment to love as Christ loved us, and for its goal, the kingdom of God. So it is that this messianic people, says the council, although it does not actually include all men, let the women not say they are excluded because it was just the Latin form men. So whenever the council says men, that translation means men and women, all. Although it does not include all men and may more than once look like a small flock, is nonetheless a lasting and sure seed of unity, hope, and salvation for the whole human race. By baptism, people get incorporated into Christ and the church. They share in the common priesthood and are empowered to offer Christian worship and receive the sacraments. The church has a universal mission to bring all humanity to faith in Jesus Christ and salvation in his name. Whether they be Catholics, paragraph 14, or other Christians, paragraph 15, or followers of other religions, paragraph 16, to promote the glory of God and procure the salvation of everyone, the church painstakingly fosters her missionary work. That means let nobody quote paragraphs 14, 15, 16 to suggest that missionary work is no longer urgent. It is urgent because, as the council says, because of the difficulty of religious truth and the weakness of human beings and also the activity of the devil who never goes on holidays, then the church has to painstakingly pursue her missionary work in order to give everybody not only the possibility of salvation, but the actuality and the availability of the abundant means of salvation. Through her work, whatever is good in the minds and hearts of men, whatever good lies latent in the religious practices and cultures of diverse peoples, is not only saved from destruction, but is also healed, ennobled, and perfected unto the glory of God, the confusion of the devil, and the happiness of man. That's paragraph 17. So missionaries are encouraged to continue full steam. In the third chapter, the Council Fathers discussed the hierarchical structure of the church with special reference to the episcopate. Christ entrusted his church to Peter and the apostles. They are succeeded by the Pope and the bishops. Together, these form a college with the Pope at the head. Diocesan bishops govern the particular churches or dioceses entrusted to them as the vicars and ambassadors of Christ. The divinely established ecclesiastical ministry, says the council, is exercised on different levels by those who from antiquity have been called bishops, priests, and deacons. Priests are united with the bishops in sacerdotal dignity. Their ministry is under the leadership of the bishop to celebrate the sacred mysteries, to preach the word of God, and to gather the people of God together. On their side, deacons have hands imposed on them for a ministry of service. Chapter 4 discusses the lay faithful. They are the followers of Christ who by baptism are made one body with Christ and are established among the people of God. They share in the priestly, prophetic, and kingly functions of Christ, who and they are sent to bring the Spirit of Christ into the different areas of the secular order, that is, the family, the professions, trade and commerce, politics and government, the mass media, national and international relations. This is a very important section to give us the theology of the lay apostolate. A secular quality is proper and special to the lay faithful. By their vocation, they seek the kingdom of God by engaging in temporal affairs and by ordering them according to the plan of God. The lay apostolate is a participation in the saving mission of the church herself. Clerics are to respect the responsibility of the lay faithful and that just freedom which belongs to everyone in this earthly city, while the laity are exhorted to obey their pastors and cooperate with them.